Good evening and a warm welcome to all. I am Mridul Mishra and on behalf of CARE Ratings, welcome you to our today's webinar on Indian fertilizer sector and sincerely appreciate your time in joining us for this webinar. Please be informed we'll be having a Q&A session at the end of the panel discussion. In case of any queries, you are please requested to key in your queries. Now may I request Gaurav Dikshit, Associate Director at CARE Ratings, who is based out of a Delhi office, to take over the proceedings, please.
Thank you, Mridul. A very warm welcome to all of you and to our distinguished guest panelists today. And thanks to them for taking out time for this webinar. I have the honor of introducing our first guest today, Mr. T.M. Muralidharan, CFO and Joint President Finance for Mangalore Chemicals and Fertilizers Limited, part of the reputed Advance Group and one of the major fertilizer manufacturers in the country. He also heads the risk management and internal audit for Advance Agribusiness. Welcome to the webinar, Mr. Muralidharan. Our second guest panelist for today is Mr. Hiranand, Executive Director of Finance for Ramagundam Fertilizers and Chemicals Limited. He is an associate member of Institute of Cost and Management Accountants. He has expertise in project financing, project contracting, cost controls, and implementation of internal controls, apart from core accounting and treasury functions. Prior to RFCL, he has also worked for NFL for about 17 years and Opal for about 4 years. Thanks for joining, Mr. Hiranand. Now, how we have planned the webinar today is that we would run through a small presentation followed by a panel discussion with our esteemed guest and thereafter take questions from the participants. So now getting on with the presentation. In the presentation, we'll be covering some key facts and figures for the fertilizer sector, trends with respect to demand, supply and production, the reforms undertaken by the government, fertilizer subsidy and how it has evolved over the years, the current challenges which the sector is facing and the way forward and outlook for the sector. We'll also touch upon the key factors impacting the credit profile and the rating dispersion for CARE. Fertilizer is a key industry for the Indian economy in terms of assuring food security to the country. India is the second largest consumer of fertilizers, in which urea accounts for over 2/3 of the overall consumption, and is also the third largest producer of nitrogenous fertilizers. China and US rank before India. In terms of production of phosphatic fertilizer, India has production capacity spread across the private and cooperative sector, whereas the requirement of potash is completely met through imports. In terms of raw materials as well, India is dependent upon imports for production of nitrogenous and phosphatic fertilizers. Product-wise, chemical fertilizers are classified into urea, diammonium phosphate, single superphosphate, muriate of potash, and other complex fertilizers like calcium ammonium nitrate and various grades of NPK fertilizers. The MRP of urea is fixed as it is controlled by the central government, and the difference between the maximum retail price and the cost of production is reimbursed to the manufacturers as subsidy by the central government. While in the case of decontrolled fertilizers, the MRP is not fixed. It is upon the manufacturers as to how they want to price it, but the subsidy rate is fixed for each variant of the fertilizer group. We'll discuss this in detail in our upcoming slides. Now, coming to the demand trends for the fertilizer, we can see the overall fertilizer consumption in India has grown at a CAGR of 2% from about 507 lakh metric tons in FY14 to 610 lakh metric tons in FY20. Talking about the current year, overall sales of the fertilizers have increased by about 25% during FY21, the April to August period. Sales of urea, DAP and MOP have increased by around 6, 28 and 15% respectively during H1 FY21. Initially, in the start of FY21, panic buying by the farmers and dealers coupled with the low prices of the commodity had led to increase in sales of fertilizer. The fertilizer demand has actually been strong since the beginning of the Kharif 2020 season. With a good monsoon, abundant water availability in the reservoirs, overall demand for fertilizers may continue to show a strong positive growth during the Rabi season as well. The total fertilizer demand for FY21 is expected to grow by around 12% vis-a-vis FY20. Due to the support offered by the government towards the growth of the fertilizer industry, there has been a rapid buildup of manufacturing units of urea, DAP and other complex fertilizers in the country, with investment in the public, cooperative and private sectors. At present, there are 31 large size urea plants in the country manufacturing urea, 21 units produce DAP and complex fertilizers, and 2 units manufacture ammonium sulfate as a byproduct. The country also has 80 medium and small scale units in operations producing single superphosphate. With respect to the 31 urea plants, 28 out of these use natural gas as feedstock fuel, while the remaining three units still uses naphtha as feedstock. However, out of these three urea plants, two, that is MCFL and Madras Fertilizers, have now very recently received the natural gas as well. The Government of India had earlier notified the new urea policy 2015 for existing gas-based urea units with objectives of maximizing indigenous urea production, promoting energy efficiency in the urea production, and rationalizing subsidy burden on the government. While India is the world's second largest consumer of urea, the Government of India is working towards increasing the production of urea so as to end imports by 2022 and achieve self-sufficiency in urea production. Out of the total fertilizer production, India produces around 58% of urea, which is widely used, while we produce only 9 to 11% of DAP, which is the second most widely used fertilizer after urea. The government is also encouraging SSP production as it is indigenous and is also considered as a substitute to diammonium phosphate, which is largely import-based and costlier. Coming to the production and import mix. As we move on, let us have a look at the production and import mix in the total requirement of the fertilizers. As we can see, out of the total demand of 649 lakh metric tons of fertilizer for FY20, India produced 426 lakh metric ton, while balance 223 lakh metric ton was met with imports. Similarly, in FY19, out of the total demand of 612 lakh metric tons, India produced 417 lakh metric tons and balance 195 was met with imports. As we have seen in the earlier slide, the urea dominates the total fertilizer production in the country. In FY20, the production of urea stood at 245 lakh metric tons, while in FY19, it was 240 lakh metric tons. On the import front, DAP and MOP are the front runners, which we shall see as we move ahead. Urea is an inexpensive form of the nitrogenous fertilizer and is synthetically produced. It contains 46% nitrogen and is the only controlled fertilizer, which means the government determines, controls its price. The cabinet has approved for the continuation of the urea subsidy, which assures that the MRP of urea will not be changed until the year 2020. The difference between the delivered cost of fertilizers at a farm gate and net market realization by the urea units is given as subsidy to the urea manufacturer or importer by the government. Domestic production of urea has been increasing as the government is providing incentives to manufacturers to produce beyond the reassessed capacity under the covenants of the new urea policy. India plans to eliminate urea imports by 2022. In this chart, we have analyzed import dependence on of urea, imports as a proportion of production plus imports. Import dependence has come down from it being around 28% during FY15 to around 23% during FY19. It, however, increased again to 27% in FY20. However, with the new units coming on stream, it is expected to reduce again in the coming years. While the present requirement of urea is around 320 to 330 lakh metric tons per annum, the current production is approximately 240 lakh metric ton. Presently, India is importing 80 to 90 lakh metric ton. The five plants which are being revived will produce an additional 62 lakh metric ton, which will bridge the gap to a large extent. Now coming to DAP, the diammonium phosphate is a concentrated fertilizer with high phosphorus and nitrogen content. Around 50 to 60% of India's DAP needs are usually imported. DAP and its blends are used on a range of broad acre farming crops such as cereals, sugarcane, sowing pastures, dairy pastures, fodder crops, and also in horticulture crops. In FY19, the production fell by around 16% on account of higher raw material prices. The phosphoric acid prices had increased by around 26%, and the industry felt it was better to import the final product rather than to manufacture it domestically. However, softening of raw material prices and a low base has aided in increasing DAP production by around 16% in FY20. Increase in production has also led to a decline in imports by around 26% in FY20. However, in the current year, as in April to August period, it has again reduced by around 13%. Primarily on account of shortage of raw material availability and labor constraints. Imports, on the other hand, have risen by around 16% in the same period. DAP and DAP blends are usually higher in demand during the Rabi sowing, and the country mainly imports DAP from China, Saudi Arabia, USA, and Jordan. Coming to MOP and SSP, potassium chloride, commonly referred as muriate of potash or MOP, is the most common potassium source used in agriculture, accounting for about 95% of all potash fertilizers used worldwide. The demand of MOP in India is entirely met by imports. India imports MOP from Russia, Jordan, Israel, and Canada. MOP is used extensively to fertilizer sugarcane, fruit trees, vegetables and other field crops. The imports have fallen by around 10% during FY19 and 11% in FY20. In the current year as well, MOP imports have fallen by around 11% during the April to August period. Now talking about SSP, it's an indigenous phosphatic multinutrient fertilizer which contains about 16% phosphate, 11% sulfur, 16% calcium and some other essential micronutrients. SSP was once the most commonly used fertilizer, but other phosphatic fertilizers have largely replaced SSP because of its relatively low phosphorus content. Because of the simple production technique, it is one of the cheapest chemical fertilizers available. It is more suited for crops like oilseeds, pulses, horticulture, vegetables, sugarcane, etc., and for sulfur deficient soils. The SSP production has grown at a rate of about 10% during FY15 to FY19. Initially, it was mandatory for SSP manufacturers to utilize minimum 50% of their recognized production capacity or produce 40 lakh metric tons, whichever is lower, per year to become eligible for subsidy under the nutrient-based scheme. However, this norm was lifted in March 2016. Hence, there has been an uptick in production from FY16 onwards. SSP was a preferred fertilizer in the previous fiscal when prices of DAP had increased due to its increase in the cost of production. Now, we are through with almost all the nutrients and let's now move towards the raw material price trends in our upcoming slides. First being the natural gas. Now, natural gas is used as a feedstock for manufacturing of urea and accounts for about 50 to 80% of the overall cost. The industry is leading consumer of domestic natural gas and is preferred as first, it is intrinsically hydrogen rich and therefore contributes more hydrogen compared to other feedstock on a unit weightage basis. And the heavier feedstock like coal and oil are more complex to process and therefore the capital costs are higher compared to the natural gas. As per the new domestic gas policy, the government revises the domestic natural gas price every 6 months, that is April to September and October to March. The price for gas, which is used for making fertilizer, generating electricity and as a fuel for automobiles, have been revised to $1.79 per MMBTU for 6 months beginning October 1, 2020, which is the lowest price ever set as per the new domestic gas policy. It's about 25% lower than the earlier price of $2.39 per MMBTU. As per our estimates, a 25% fall in natural gas prices could potentially lead to a 12% decrease in cost of production of urea, thus decreasing the working capital intensity of the fertilizer manufacturers, and it will also act as a relief for the fiscal base of the government while disbursing the urea subsidy, which is already under pressure. The prices of RLNG are usually governed by the market dynamics based on contracts and are linked with the global crude oil prices. However, soon fertilizer plants can take delivery on India's first gas exchange, the Indian Gas Exchange, which has been launched in the start of FY21. The exchange currently is only dealing with delivery of imported natural gas and not of domestic natural gas, which is a formula driven thing. Moving on, let us see the trend in the price of other key raw materials. Raw material prices increased on a whole during FY19 as plant closures in China and higher global demand impacted the availability. Prices of phosphoric acid, rock phosphates, ammonia and sulfur had increased by about 25, 9, 6 and 11% respectively during FY19. However, there was a fall of about 13, 15, 27 and 41% respectively during FY20 for the same commodities. The manufacturers have passed on the benefit of softer raw material prices by lowering the MRP of the decontrolled fertilizers. The prices of these commodities have continued to remain range bound during the current financial year as well. And manufacturers have also passed on the benefits of soft raw material prices by lowering the MRP of decontrolled fertilizers, which has also led to increase in the sales. Now, I'd like to hand over to Ravleen for giving our perspective on the fertilizer subsidy.
Thank you, Gaurav, and a very good evening to you all. Before we talk about the subsidy, I'll just take you all through the reforms and the government initiatives. As you all can see in the current slide, we have summarized few of the reforms of the government initiatives which have been undertaken in the fertilizer industry in the past, and we'll quickly give you a walkthrough through all of them. The first one being the new urea policy, in 2015, which was revised. So it was introduced with the main purpose to ensure the maximum production of indigenous urea by promoting the use of the fertilizer efficient feedstock, which will help rationalize and bring down the subsidy burden. And we all well know the norms under this policy. Now, with this new urea policy, it was expected that there would be a reduction in the subsidy burden of the government through the two ways, which would be reduction in the specific energy consumption norms with the gradual tightening and import substitution on account of the higher domestic production. So basically, the new urea policy was aiming to make the domestic urea industry more globally competitive. Neem coating being another reform of the government, all the urea producers in the country had to mandatorily produce 100% of their total production of the subsidized urea as neem coated urea. So it is the most cost effective way to preserve the nitrogen competent in the fertilizer and even increase the crop yield. This was introduced in 2015 again. Since NCU, which is the neem coated urea, cannot be used for industrial purpose, the illegal diversion of the subsidized urea to non-agricultural use was not possible. And also by curbing this illegal diversion of the urea for the non-agricultural purpose, the government aims to prevent the subsidy leakages also, which were happening. They were getting transported to some nearby countries. Also, neem coated urea is 5% over and above the MRP of the normal urea. The third main measure is the gas pooling for the fertilizer sector. The cost of the gas, which is the most important component for the production of urea, it varies from plant to plant, owing to the differential rates at which the imported LNG is contracted, and as well as it depends upon the cost of the transportation. So under this policy, the Government of India proposed pooling of domestic gas with regasified LNG, which is imported. And this would help provide natural gas at uniform delivered prices to all the natural gas grid-connected urea manufacturing plants. And the move significantly helped to bring down the cost of the fuel. Another measure was the revision of that happened in the dealer margin. So for smoothing the implementation of the DBT, which is the direct benefit transfer, there was a revision done in the dealer margin. And it was paid on the quantity sold through the POS devices only. This enhanced the financial viability of many dealers post the DBT implementation. Moving on, in the next slide, we have another two important reforms that the government took. One was the direct benefit transfer, which we were just talking about. The introduction of the direct benefit transfer in the fertilizer industry was expected to be a boon to the sector. Now, under the DBT, the 100% of the payment to the fertilizer manufacturing companies is on the basis of the actual sales by the retailer to the beneficiary. So the farmer or the buyer's identity is authenticated either through the biometric or the Aadhaar card or unique identification number. And the sales to the beneficiaries are captured through the point of sale machines installed at the retailer's end. Now, all the fertilizer sales transactions are captured online in the integrated fertilizer management system. The claims are processed on a weekly basis. Implementation of DBT system has streamlined the fertilizer distribution, but the model of DBT implemented is not DBT in true sense. It only prolonged the delay in the payment of the subsidy, which was earlier paid on the receipt of the material in a district. So we'll cover this in later up in the coming up slides. Let us just see the last measure which the government is taking up, which is the revival of the closed fertilizer plants. The government is reviving the 5 closed fertilizer plants. 4 of them are with Fertilizer Corporation of India, with Talcher, Ramagundam, Gorakhpur and Sindri. And one of them being in HFCL, which is the Hindustan Fertilizer Corporation Limited. It is in Baruni. So this is being done by setting up the new ammonia urea plants with a capacity of approximately 12.7 lakh metric tons per annum. And the government expects that the commissioning start of the above plants can increase the indigenous urea production significantly. It will lead to a reduction in the substantial amount of the imports that we do and will make India self-sufficient. These points were just touched by Gaurav a while back also. So speaking on the progress of these fertilizer plants, Ramagundam has already achieved 99% of the progress. There was some delay due to the COVID and the completion is there. The project is already in the pre-commissioning stages. While the others, the Gorakhpur, Sindri and the Baruni, they have 80% of the progress achieved. But these plants are expected to start the production by 2021. And post the commissioning of all these plants, the domestic indigenous urea is slated to increase and it may bring down the imports approximately by 70% if we assume the FY20 import levels. We now move on to a very important aspect and much talked about in this sector, which is the fertilizer subsidy. The fertilizer industry is highly regulated and monitored by the government. We all know that. Now, the difference between the cost of the production, which is higher than the price at which the fertilizer is sold to the beneficiary, is reimbursed by the government in the form of subsidies. Whenever there is a shortage of funds, the government liquidates the pending subsidy by arranging a special banking arrangement. This generally comes around February or March of every year. Now, while the MRP of urea is fixed and controlled by the central government, that is not the case with the decontrolled fertilizers, wherein the manufacturers have the liberty to price the product freely and accordingly to the prevailing market conditions. So under the nutrient-based subsidy, or the NBS, how we call, the subsidy is given to the companies is fixed annually on the basis of its nutrient content. Like which is the nitrogen, phosphate, potash, and sulfur on per kg basis, which is then converted into subsidy per ton depending upon the nutrient content in each grade of the fertilizer. So these rates are determined taking into account many factors like international and domestic prices of PNK fertilizers, exchange rate, inventory levels in the country. For FY21, if you all see in the table, which is there down below in the slide, there has been a downward revision for the nutrients covered into the NBS. The rupees per kg rates of all the nutrients under the NBS over the years, that is, the prices set for FY20 are lower than what were there in FY20. And pending subsidy due has been a chronic problem affecting the liquidity position of the country. Moving on, let us just see the trends in the fertilizer subsidy, how it has been. So there was an outstanding amount of 39,000 crores at the start of the financial year 20, which was carried forward from the previous years. And approximately 80,000 crores was allocated for financial year 20, which was grossly inadequate to meet the requirements of the reporting year, including the backlog which it was carrying from the previous year. Thus, the unpaid subsidy due, in spite of the banking arrangement which happened in March for 10,000 crores from a special banking arrangement, the end of the year, the unpaid subsidy stood at 48,000, more than 48,000 crores at the end of the financial year 20. And out of this total unpaid dues, the majority portion, approximately 70 to 72%, we can say, was for the urea units. So the budgeted allocation for FY21 also, it reduced further by 12% from approximately to 71,309 crores. Out of this, 47,000 approximately was earmarked for urea, and the remaining has been earmarked for the nutrient-based subsidy. So we have stated the figures in the table also with, there, and we can see that it's a 12% reduction from the earlier budget. Now, the trend has been like every year, center uses a part of the available funds to pay the pending subsidy liabilities, which are carried forward from the previous years, and hence a vicious circle of the backlog is getting created in subsidy, and it has been created over the years, we can see. So this backlogs keep resulting in the elevated working capital requirements for the industry, which accentuates then the interest outgo and weakens the credit profile of players. So in the next slide, we are now looking at the budget estimates of this financial year and how the subsidy outgo was looking vis-a-vis the earlier periods. In the first table, if you see, we have shown the trends of the release in the subsidy in the past period and the current financial year. This data covers the period from April to August for the respective periods. And we can see that urea has concerned a higher percentage of the allocated budgeted amount, as already has been spent in the case of urea, given the buoyant demand trend in the current financial year. And also in the aftermath of COVID-19, a new expenditure management regime was implemented where the Department of Fertilizer was clubbed under the category B, which means that it would be entitled just to spend 80% of the allocated budget for financial year 21. Which means that out of 71,309 crore, only 80% was allowed to the Department of Fertilizer to be used in financial year 21. Now, the government had already paid that approximately 78% by the end of September 2020 only, that we have stated in the table two. So in the corresponding period, however, for the previous financial year, this amount was approximately 70%. So given the increase in the sale of the fertilizer, which is happening in the current financial year, the unpaid subsidy at the year end was slated to increase, considering the government has already spent 78%. And the backlog that the industry has been carrying forward further would have widened by the end of the financial year 21, given the strong volume growth we are witnessing. This could have again impacted the liquidity position of the players. However, as we all know, a fresh subsidy was announced by the government. And is it really subsiding the pain? Let us just take a quick look. So a stimulus of 65,000 odd crores was announced by the for the fertilizer industry in the package of the COVID-19 by the finance minister. And in our view, we see that, yes, it has a positive side. The industry subsidy bill for the current financial year was expected approximately 80,000 crores. And if we club the backlog, which we were carrying of 48,000 crores, the requirement was for 128,000 crores approximately. So if we see the initial budget, which is 71,000 crores approximately, clubbing with the 65,000 crores, the new stimulus which is announced, we have a total budgeted amount of 136,000 crores. So if the major subsidy amount is cleared well in time by the government out of the allocated funds, then financial year 22 could be a year where the industry will start with minimum due spending. However, on the right-hand side of the current slide, we have just mentioned the key points that still needs to be addressed by the government. So one-time stimulus, though a positive industry, however, needs a fiscal sustainability. Transfer of the subsidy also in the true sense is required. So clearing subsidies in a way we are seeing is paving way for other reform spending to be implemented in the fertilizer sector. Because we feel that if these reforms are not implemented in due course, they shall again lead to backlogs being created. So before we talk about the way forward in these reforms, we'd like you all to walk you through the what these half-baked reforms are all about. So we've just listed a few pointers in the process chart here that how the current reforms are creating gaps in the subsidy. And this slide is focusing on urea, as we've already seen that the industry is very skewed towards the nitrogen content, because it has a higher portion of subsidy, which is approximately 70% of the cost of the urea. And subsidy on other fertilizers is in the range of 30 to 35% basically of their cost. So fertilizer sector consumes approximately 30% of the natural gas produced and imported in the country. And supply of gas from existing fields have been inadequate to cater to the needs of the sector. The shortfall in the availability of the gas from domestic sources is fulfilled through high cost imported, which is LNG. And the imported gas component in the total consumption pattern has gone up over the years. Like, it has gone up from 41% to approximately 58% in 19 and has remained at a similar level in financial year 20. So the urea manufacturing plants have high working capital intensity than other decontrolled fertilizers, since subsidy portion is high in the sale price of the urea. While the farmer's price, which is the MRP, remains fixed, it increases the urea subsidy, like for any increase in the raw material cost that is happening. So imported gas being more expensive than the domestic gas, the cost of the production of urea has been increasing over the years only. And urea industry, any which ways in the past, has suffered due to the unfavorable policies which pertain to the non-payment of the increased fixed cost and non-recognition of the further increase, tightening of the energy consumption norms. So all these policies are partly responsible for the imprudent use of the inputs and creating sustainability issues in the urea sector. Therefore, in the interest of all the stakeholders, we definitely feel there is a need for relooking at the fertilizer reforms. And moving on, we'll quickly just summarize all the current challenges that are plaguing the sector, which is the first one is the imbalanced use of the fertilizer. About this challenge, we have already gone through in our last slide that why the industry is so much bent towards the urea. And it is not just deteriorating the soil nutrient component over the years, but is also leading to higher subsidy bills of the government every year. Then tightening of the operational and energy norms is the next one. This one is the energy consumption norms have been reduced 4 times after the implementation of the NPS policy in 2003. So this has been done without recognizing the investments made for achieving such energy efficiency. So policies and their implementation have badly impacted the viability of the urea plants. Few of the operating plants are running under losses, and the rest of the plants are also running at very thin margins. Another issue which is plaguing the sector is also the inverted duty structure for the PNK and higher GST on the inputs. So domestic manufacturing in the PNK fertilizer is suffering due to unfavorable and inverted tax structures vis-a-vis the finished fertilizers. Custom duty on potassic acid and ammonia is approximately 5%, which is same as on the finished fertilizers also. And custom duty on the rock phosphate and sulfur is 2.5%. So basically, these import duties on raw materials and intermediaries increase the cost of the domestic manufacturing, making them uncompetitive compared to the imports. Similarly, inverted GST rate on ammonia and sulfur acid at 18% compared to 5% on the fertilizer increases the cost of the domestic production. So due to these unfavorable taxation regime, also the capacity utilization of the domestic phosphatic players has been declining. It has declined approximately 70% in 2011 to close to 60-65% in 19 and 20. Inadequate budget allocation has been a bane for the sector, which we've already gone through, and subsidy continues to be routed through the industry. So implementation of DBT assured the weekly payment of the subsidy. However, the implementation of DBT has postponed the DBT payment system only, because now it is linked to the sale of fertilizers through POS machines. Earlier, it used to be paid on receipt of the material in the district. So this has also increased the working capital and further the borrowings and the interest cost for the industry. So what is the way forward for the sector to remain fertile? We have quickly summarized a few of the measures which probably we see, and even the industry has been requesting the government. The first being the balanced use of the plant nutrients. First and foremost, it should encourage the balanced use of the plant nutrients in the integration with the organic sources. The efficient use of nitrogen in agriculture will have to be part of the strategy for the sustainable nitrogen management. One of the important considerations to promote the efficient use of nitrogen is the pricing of the nitrogen through different products. Now, it should be same through different products, and it should only be in correspondence with the prices of the other two primary sources, like the phosphorus and the potash. Therefore, new policy has to ensure that there is no distortion in the prices of the different nutrients. Obviously, price of the urea would remain an overriding factor in the pattern of the farm nutrients. So maybe we can implement the NPS policy for urea is one of the measures that we can take. Moving on to the next one, that would be the viability of the domestic production in the industry. So present policies for the sector have put the domestic production of both the urea and the NPK fertilizers at a disadvantage vis-a-vis the imports. The policy of the reform should ensure the viability of the domestic production. As such, India is the second largest consumer of the fertilizer in the world, but is heavily dependent on the imports of the raw materials and even the finished products. So reasonable return on the investments in urea production facilities and probably is one of the factors that we can consider. Addressing the taxation regime and timely settling of the bill of the fertilizer plants are the things that need to be addressed by the governments in the new approach. Further, a roadmap has to be defined by wherein the subsidy gets transferred into farmers' account directly and shall not be routed through the industry, because unnecessarily the working capital borrowings of the industry player goes higher. The last and the most important is the fiscal sustainability. Now, government is, over the years, there have been inadequate provisions in the budgets. However, one-time stimulus has been announced this year, but a fiscal sustainability is required for the industry as a whole. Also, few measures can be in the form of like the extension of the credit period from 60 to 180 days for financing of the working capital by banks against the subsidy receivables. And also the extension of the credit by the gas suppliers can be another things. So to summarize the entire thing, this one-time subsidy provision by the government is a welcome step as we see for the sector for clearing the backlogs. And it has paved the way for other reforms also to be implemented that which shall help in the long-term sustenance of the sector. Coming to the impact of the COVID on the sector and opportunities, if it is offering any, the fertilizer sector falls under the essential commodities, as we all know, and accordingly, it was exempted from the lockdown restrictions, which were applicable on the other manufacturing sectors. So not much impact on this sector. Essential commodity and lockdown also coincided with the seasonally soft period. However, there were record sales in April and May, despite the lockdown. But yes, lockdown was posing challenges for continuous operations of the fertilizer plants in terms of pressure on their working capital borrowings because the demand was very high. But center also announced additional stimulus to take care of that same. Fertilizer players are also expected to benefit from the lower input prices, which is the phosphate and potassium players specifically. And a subsidy softening of the gas prices will also help the urea sector. So lower gas cost through pass-through will lower the subsidy outgo from the government. This shall even ease the pressure on the working capital borrowings of the players. Also, we feel the decontrol of the urea, which we were just talking about, probably it's a very good time to implement these as the gas prices are expected to stay low only for some period. So for the fertilizer sector, the breakout of COVID is offering, in fact, an opportunity to just crack the whip. Moving on. To the key factors impacting the credit profile of the players. Now, we have listed the important factors which are assessed by CARE in analyzing the credit profile of the industry players in this sector. The first one being the regulatory framework in energy efficiency. The fertilizer industry being a highly regulated industry, government policies for the industry and their impact on the specific company is a key input in the framework for rating of the fertilizer companies. Any change or modification in the policy framework within which the industry operates, it has a bearing on the overall business profile and profitability of a fertilizer company. So, and government control is bound to exist in the sector, some form or the other, and will continue to play an important role. Energy efficiency of the fertilizer production is indicated by the kilocalories of feedstock used to manufacture one unit of the final product. So energy efficiency in turn depends on the type of the feedstock used, the vintage and technology of the plants, and efficiency of the O&M. Under the existing system of the subsidy component, the actual energy consumption level for urea units has been taken into consideration for setting up the energy norms, and the units have been classified into three groups based on the vintage and technology. So we believe the energy efficient units would be able to compete against the imports. So the better output will result in improved cash flows. Accordingly, these factors are taken into account while analyzing the credit profile of an entity. Moving on, very critically, it is analyzed what is the product profile, market position, and size of a player. The fertilizer companies in India could range from a single product, single location company to a large multi-product fertilizer complexes and the plants having in multiple locations. So we take into account a company's product profile and size as compared with other companies in the similar industry. Working capital intensity is another factor. The shortfall in the subsidy budget is usually affects the cash flow position of a company in the second half of the financial year when the budget allocated budget gets exhausted. So companies resort to the short-term borrowings to fund the extended subsidy receivable. Hence, it is also a very important factor which is analyzed by the rating agencies. Moving on, it is the agroclimatic risk. So the fertilizer sale in India would depend on the monsoon, since most of the regions are dependent upon rains for irrigation only. So this leads to higher fertilizer sales during the normal monsoon period, which we are witnessing this year, and while the lower sales during the drought or low rainfall period. So during the period of low rainfall, the fertilizer companies may be impacted in terms of the increased channel inventory, which may also impact its working capital borrowings and can also lead to discounts or larger credit period to increase the sales. So presence in geographically diverse areas may mitigate the agroclimatic risk to some extent, and that is how it is taken into account while analyzing the credit profile of a player. Moving on, it is the modernization plans of a company. So India majorly has urea manufacturing units, which are based on the natural gas as feedstock. And however, with increased focus on the efficiency, these plants will have to undergo the modernization in terms of the debottlenecking and revamping. CARE Ratings believe that for majority of the urea units and energy saving projects need to be undertaken to achieve the target group benchmark energy consumption norms, which are there. And for doing this, the gearing for the entities in the fertilizer industry is usually high because of the large working capital borrowing. So basically, the proposed modernization plans are viewed, and funding patterns are also viewed in the light of the benefits that all these would accrue to a particular company. Next up is the feedstock and the foreign exchange risk. Naphtha and natural gas have been the main feedstocks used for the manufacturing of urea. And fertilizer units in the country today are faced with gas shortages. And under certain circumstances, CARE views the ability of the company to have a long-term tie-up of the gas requirements at the competitive rate. Also, in cases of the phosphatic fertilizers, the main raw material is the phosphoric acid. The country depends on a large extent on the imports of the phosphoric acid. So backward integration into the production of the acid or firming up of the sourcing arrangements would be the important considerations which would be looked at. And also, we believe that the type of the feedstock and the raw material used and the sourcing arrangement for the same and the ability to control the energy cost of a particular entity is a very important factor. The fertilizer companies also import the raw materials while selling the finished products in the domestic markets, thus exposing the companies to the FX risk also. So how a particular company is managing that is also something which is very important and analyzed. And as we are heading almost to the end of our presentation, let us quickly briefly summarize the sector outlook. The demand for their outlook is buoyant, which is driving on a surplus reservoir levels, good monsoons, and elevated sowing. Subsidy bills were slated to rise by the end of financial year 21, exerting pressure on the players. However, the additional stimulus is a positive for the industry. The COVID-19 impact has been negligible, and the revival of the closed plants for the urea capacity is happening, which we have just seen. And urea manufacturers are expected to benefit with the current low gas prices, and gas prices have further fallen during the second revision. Another positive for the urea makers is also the clarity which the government provided in March 20 with regards to the reimbursement of the additional fixed cost. Further, the DAP prices are also low, which will have an impact on the working capital borrowing of the decontrolled fertilizer manufacturers as well. And falling of the raw material prices is a positive both from a margin perspective as well as the working capital management. Now, look on the rating dispersion and migration of the ratings for the sector players with CARE Ratings. First, the rating dispersion, the share of the companies in each rating band and their movement also. Few of the companies, apart from the core fertilizer business, they might be into a few chemical business also, and the movement in those businesses also may have an impact. However, largely, we have these companies have a fertilizer business only. So high-rated companies are the large urea and the DAP manufacturers, and quite a few PSUs and cooperatives are included there. Also, these high-rated companies are both in public and private sector. They have a diversified product portfolio, and it gets them heads up against the volatility which is happening in particularly in any one product. BBB and below are the largely SSP manufacturers or the NPK manufacturers or some traders. They are typically confined to a particular region, and they even have lower margins. And talking about the migrations in the rating, which is the second graph on the slide, this sector is fairly stable portfolio with higher share of the reaffirmations only. A few large working capital requirements and elongation in the collections are the reasons for the rating revision in this sector. With this, we come to the end of our presentation. And now, to get the industry perspective from our esteemed speakers, I'll hand it over to Gaurav, who will take us forward.
Thank you, Ravli. Against the backdrop of the points presented just now, we would now try to get some valuable insights from our panelists. My first question would quite obviously be about the prevailing situation brought about by the COVID and how the fertilizer sector has remained one of the very few sectors which have not been impacted much and has shown strong performance during the current year. So maybe I'll start with Mr. Muralidharan. As a leading player in this space, how has been your experience this year, and what do you attribute the strong performance of the sector to? Sir, you are on mute.
Thank you. It's a good presentation made by both of you. So, a good question. See, this year, despite the COVID challenges we faced, this year supposed to be a very great our year in terms of the good rainfall we had. See, you could see that 1819-1920, so 2 years we had a good successive good rainfall, especially in the region where we operate in southern India. And this year, third year, we followed succession. In fact, pan India, this what we call rainfall has been very copious rain we had. So that augured very well for this industry, number one. In the COVID, as covered in your presentations, the support given by the central government and the respective state governments to keep the production going and also remove the pain points in the movement of material, fertilizers, it really helped the industry to keep the production and all supply at a great level. Number three is the Atmanirbhar package, which is given now, this shot in the arm for every industry, for all the players in the industry, which will help us to get all the backlog of subsidies paid out, which will be very good in terms of an leverage in the debt, which will help us to deleverage their borrowings and close this financial year FY21 on a very positive note. So many, I think all the companies, if this the disbursement happens in a gradually starting, we expect to start from January, February, March. So you will see that I think best year of the borrowings or all the companies will be reflected as we go forward. That another one. Another big what you call challenge, or sorry, the advantage what we see this year is the reverse migration of the labor force, which is moving from the urban areas to back to the villages, and made the availability of labor also at the respective states where they are able to get into farming. That also, given with the rain coming in a very copious quantity, also helped the sector to revive. So these are factors, and there is no disruption of the supply chain during the year for all the raw materials, be it is majority of the raw materials are imported, as you covered in the presentations, either it's RLNG for the urea production, or it is a phosphoric acid, ammonia, all getting imported. So for the complex manufacturing, so there is no impact on supply chain. That also been very positive for us. And biggest one, the advantage is the we are COVID-free, COVID-proof industry. We will say this in fertilizer industry, which helped us to see this. It's a game changer for us for this year. And with this Atmanirbhar 3.0 stimulus given, that will definitely reflect the financials in terms of an leverage. And also in FY21, we are not going to start with any backlog of an receivables, which will see a positive passage in terms of an reduced finance cost in FY21 as well.
Okay. Great to know, sir. So, sir, with the strong offtake of fertilizers, the import of fertilizers is also expected to remain high this year. Mr. Hiranand, as we know, government has been taking various steps to ensure self-sufficiency in fertilizer production, especially urea. So, what's your view on the government's policy for new investment in the sector, and how has been the experience so far?
That's a good question. Basically, government Atmanirbhar has come literally. But government is, since long back, working on to it. Fertilizer sector should be Atmanirbhar since way back, since 2010. So that is the idea that came with the concept of revival of units. And otherwise also, no any investment was coming into the industry, urea industry particularly, for increasing the capacity of production capacity of urea. So with this, these four or five plants are coming, and those will be mitigating up to 70-80% of the present imports. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, there has been a very good growth in market demand. If you look at current year scenario, there is 24-25% increase in demand this current year itself. So basically, maybe we'll be in a better position. Of course, we'll be mitigating current demand supply gap. But otherwise, we would have been a very, very difficult situation. At the same time, I'd like to bring out one thing more. Because of these bringing in these new renewable plants, there will be additional burden of subsidy onto the government. So it's a good sign. Hopefully, we would be we'll be closing this year with nil pending subsidy bills. But henceforth, government has to take some steps either to increase the urea prices, or mm-hmm. if the government intend to foot the subsidy bill, they have to increase the allocation.
Okay.
And form of urea price increase, what I feel is government has done a wonderful thing in respect of kerosene.
Mm-hmm.
So kerosene prices were increased in a very phased manner, or if we look at petroleum products, which was never thought of that it will be done like this. So hopefully that is the method can be adopted for urea as well. This is my personal view.
Sure. So Mr. Muralidharan, coming to the subsidy payment mechanism, Mr. Hiradhan also said, as we discussed during our presentation as well, the delay in receipt of subsidy remains a perennial issue with this sector. In spite of the DBT being introduced, the scenario has not changed very vastly. So what's your view on the same, sir? How do you see things improving over here?
See, DBT in the true sense is not been implemented as covered in the presentation also. So still the subsidies are given to the manufacturers or importers, and we passed on what called, which is not the desired ultimate objective of DBT. So mm-hmm. that is the first point on response. So the second piece is this DBT has really brought in a lot of discipline in what call in the importers. Earlier, many people, especially the importers, they bring in materials, they get subsidy 90%, 95%, especially complex, 90% mm-hmm. they get it. And they try to bring in and dump the market. And now with this particular DBT has come in, subsidy is only linked to the consumption. And in the year of consumption, the subsidy rates also being decided. When the subsidy rates change, then since it is linked to the consumption, the subsidy also will come down if the prices drop in prices. So that brought in a lot of discipline in the players. They don't bring in huge volumes and flood the market and create unnecessary channel stock, and leading to working capital borrowings and resultant finance cost. So this DBT mm-hmm. has brought in a check on our very professional stock holding or inventory management system. And also the consumption, the subsidy outgo to the government is linked to the consumption. Nevertheless, there's pressure on the companies. So we need to really time the market, time the sales, ensure that the production of the what we call the stock, the inventory is based on the consumption. So the production or import will be very linked, aligned to the what is storage levels of water, what is the cropping pattern, what is the areas available for cultivation, second crop, third crop. So those, that alignment with the market and the study of the market, and accordingly, either you import the fertilizers and also production of fertilizers and matching that, it's a very positive step. So ultimate benefit of this will start happening. Right now, if you see that the availability of fertilizers are very, a number of compared to consumption is very desirable level, not very excessive levels. So these are the benefits which is happening in DBT. Going forward, this industry, since it's the third year, see, I think from January 18 is the pan-national level, this DBT was implemented after pilot studies in 17 and 18, the early part of, and what I call 16, later part of 16 and 17. So this 3 years has taught us many companies how we have to be disciplined in the timing of the imports, the product mix we choose, and we're able to effectively, efficiently use the working capital. So these are positives we look at as an industry. Albeit, this is really posed another challenge as covered by Ravleen also, that this has really pushed the working capital cycle by minimum of 2 to 6 months, depending upon the product, depending upon the crop, and depending upon the region where we sell the goods. Okay. This is my understanding of DBT. And see, any situation, any initiative taken by government will have a positive and not a negative. So we need to look at the positives, convert and the negatives into positives, and learn from the. See, the objective of the government is to ensure that there's no unnecessary stocking and channel stocks and leading to unnecessary finance costs. That is being well achieved by DBT. Okay, so anyhow, unless the DBT, again, the DBT disbursement is happening within a week as per the promised DBT policy, that moment the government with this stimulus 3.0 is given, I hope the adequate subsidy available any point of time to disbursement within a weekly basis. That also further support the industry to just-in-time concept of bring the materials which consumption-driven and get the subsidy within 1 week. That will be a great thing. And that is a delay what government is also targeting, and also the fertilizer industry is looking at it.
Right, sir. So, Mr. Hiranand, you just gave an example of kerosene, wherein the government took the bold step. So, one of the things which can lead to rationalization of subsidy outgo is decontrolling the price of urea. How do you see that happening, sir?
See that I understand urea pricing being a for government maybe a very politically sensitive issue, and increasing the urea prices in a one go by 20-30-40% like that, it happened in the past, and there those were to be rolled back in the past and past past vision itself. So probably a very maybe some 10 rupees or 50 rupees a ton every month or something, or a quarterly basis, that would be the best thing to happen, so that people will be aware of that. Because see, practically, let us see. In case of most of the companies, 75-80% revenue top line is on account of subsidy only. Right. So companies realize how much? Maybe 25%, less than 25%. So consumer is getting it at throwaway price. For them, there is no value. That is the reason it's a discriminate use of fertilizer urea, and that is spoiling the whole of the environment and many adverse impact of it. So whosoever is buying, there a realization has to come.
Right, sir.
For that, to make it a simpler, government has to make a phase manner increase, maybe 100 rupees a ton on quarterly basis or something. That would be most acceptable formula, probably, I feel.
Okay.
Because see, basically what government is concentrating on how to reduce the consumption.
True.
Right? Number of bags, you reduce number of bags, 100 bags, then POS and all those things. Now on to the companies, they have imposed this energy norms. Now energy norms, if you use database is available with you, most of the companies are working at that level only. Now, if we go for energy saving schemes, there is no question for that. It's a capital incentive industry. Any energy saving scheme would not cost less than 300-400 crores for each unit. From where the money will come? Fertilizer industry otherwise also is highly stressed because of high leverage. Fixed marketing cost is going on for years. It has not been revised. There are some companies. Those have been adversely affected because of this fixed marketing cost revised in the March.
True.
So government has to take all dimensions of this this problem, not concentrating only onto consumption.
Okay. So Mr. Muralidharan, as just Mr. Hiranan just mentioned about the energy consumption norms, one step is the government had taken, I think it has helped the government in reducing the subsidy outgo to a large extent, was the gradual tightening of the energy consumption norms. Do you think it has outlived its utility now and the new innovative ideas are required, or there is still some scope for significant savings in energy consumption for the Indian fertilizer sector?
Yeah, see it's a very what you call a hot topic in among the industry players. See, the two components drive the subsidy value. One is energy consumption and the cost of feedstock. Cost of feedstock is purely external. And unless India is able to get a cheaper domestic gas fines and able to allocate the entirely to the fertilizer industry requirements, then the subsidy will, there could be control. Second option is, easy option is to mandate all the companies to reduce energy consumption. So up to states only we can innovating ourselves and bring in the reduction in the consumption norms. So we can work up to the bone. We can work. We can't lose the bone. So I think all the companies are embarking on initiatives which are able to bring. So see, now if you see, there is a spectrum of the existing urea-based companies. Only few are maybe about 10 companies are pre 90 levels. Majority of them are post 90, either gas-based or what you call technologies. Their configuration they started off. So those people have done the maximum achievement. They cannot go beyond this. Even the pre-90 or vintage companies like MCFL and to name a few, even Zori Agrochemicals, Speak and all, we have up to a stage we can keep reducing by spending the capex. The huge capex, as Mr. Hiranand was telling, we cannot, not sustainable, or the viability is not there. So up to stage, we can keep doing investing small capex and get achieve the benefit. Ultimately, new ideas have to come. See, government now, how they revived the closed units. The very fact that some units were closed and we are revived the five units, clearly comes out there is an, there are two choices we have. One is, you go for a new technologies, there is new plant with it, like the five units have gone for less technologies, where their energy consumption will be around the 5 GCal per ton. That is, the information I have. So then that means government has to incentivize the, companies for a capital subsidy. Maybe or they should give at the capital at a very cheap rate of 5% or 3%, 5%. Then people will borrow and do business. Then borrowing at 11, 10% doesn't make sense. That's the one option we have. Other one is maybe innovation has to come in types of, and we can able to, like in European countries and US, where they do the ammonia feed, liquid ammonia be fed to the land. Okay, so that type of, and taking ammonia, liquid ammonia taking to the soil. There are, see, like this, something has to come. Okay. See, similarly, people talking about producing urea from water and air. Okay, maybe 5-10 years away, technology will come. So that will maybe change the entire consumption. That will change the subsidy regime. That is maybe 5-10 years. And for all the companies who have invested money now, okay, they should recover this cost within 8-10 years time. Beyond 10 years, these technologies will take over, and whatever investment made will become totally infructuous. Okay, these are my understanding at a distance.
So Mr. Hiranand, as sir mentioned about some future technologies, so we hear a lot about nano fertilizers, organic fertilizers, etc. We also read about adverse environmental impact from the excessive use of the fertilizers. So what's your view on the same, sir? Do you see these things happening in the near future?
Yes, sir, it's a reality as far as adverse impact of excessive use of fertilizers. Mm-hmm. Those are realities. It is evident from Punjab. For quite long, 8-10 years now, the fertility has come down, water level is down, soil nutrient level is quite down. So there are many adverse impact of it. That is reason many other things are happening. Like in I was reading somewhere, Sikkim is the first state having organic farming, 100% organic farming, only the state in whole of the world. That's a nice idea. These things should come up. So organic fertilizer, nano fertilizer, I have heard of this introduced by IFCO last year only. It is commercially launched also. So it's only 1 year, and what is claimed as per research of IFCO that their use of this nano fertilizer, urea, will reduce 50% consumption of urea. It's a good, it's a marvelous. But now we are yet to see the results, how it performs. How it has acceptability in the market, how it is used by the farmers, whether they are able to use it judiciously, because government is doing everything left and right, whatever government can do. Soil health card is one of the issues. Soil health card government is planning to issue to all the farmers. Now, question is whether our farmers shall be able to understand that much. They'll be really rely onto it and exactly follow it, then it will be very useful.
Okay. So, sir, my final question to both of you would be, what's one thing that you want from the government to ensure that the health of the sector continues to remain strong? Maybe Mr. Muralidharan can take it first.
What do we industry feel? We need a clarity of the policy. The policy also must not be tinkered with within a very short span of time. Okay. So, that must be a longevity to the policy, so that we're able to plan the investments, execution, and release the benefits, so that we are able to make meaningful investments in terms of energy efficiency or in terms of reduction the cost. So if those all policy and there's no engagement also with the fertilizer industry, and there must be a proper study before any particular policy initiatives are being initiated or moved, with the consultative process, it'd be more meaningful. Maybe even the industry can come with better suggestions to how to improve, and ultimately everybody is interested in ensuring that health of the economy is also well maintained. Economy starts with the government, and also economy, we are part of the government, and all of us are part of the government. We are also our health is also maintained. So somebody's health cannot be compromised with the health of the other person. So it must be an win-win situation. That would be our approach. So to summarize a single bullet point, there must be a clear our longevity or clarity on the policies, commitment from the government saying that 5 years, you won't touch this policy, 8 years, you won't touch, so that we're able to make meaningful investments. This is from my side.
Okay. Mr. Hiranand?
Yes. So Mr. Muralidharan has covered most of the things, almost all. Most important is consistency and clarity. Mm-hmm. These are the two most important aspects. I feel that is one of the reasons because not many players in the India are from abroad are interested into investing into fertilizer industry in India. And some of the private players who were there probably not very, very satisfied, or they are disinvesting. And you may have seen Tata Fertilizer and some other players. Mm-hmm. So because of the issues, non-clarity, subsidy, like we are discussing time and again. APM case, industry was getting 80-90% way back. Now it is reduced to 30%. Because of that, subsidy burden is increasing. Now, it is not because of inefficiency of the industry, subsidy burden. Because of we are not getting APM case, we are going for LNG, so naturally subsidy will increase. As far as efficiency of industry is concerned, I have heard of Indian fertilizer industry is the best energy efficient and globally. They meet in international criteria. So that is what best industry can do.
Correct.
So what is more required from government is consistency and clarity in the policy. Like right. Fixed cost, we are tracking. It has come in March. After how many years? It has to be revised every at a particular time frame. And everybody should be aware how much we are going to get. So clarity will come and investment will definitely come. Everybody would be interested into the business. That's all.
Right. Thanks a lot, sir. So now we'll be opening the floor for the audience questions. The participants may key in the questions, which we'll be passing on to our participants.
While most of the questions probably have already been answered from an industry perspective by Mr. Muralidharan and Mr. Hiranand already, we just have, I think, a couple of them. So one of the participants is asking, Mr. Muralidharan, that the urea prices globally are lower than the domestic production cost only. So why does the government want to reduce the import dependence? I think it was covered in the webinar though, but however, sir, maybe from your perspective, the participant is definitely asking. So they are asking that urea prices globally are lower only. So why is government basically wanting to reduce the import dependence?
This is exactly the experience what we saw in about 10 years back when the India went to the global market to import huge volumes. Then you see the prices have doubled, tripled. Okay, so the import prices have shot up. See, the moment India enters to the market to import, the prices go up. Okay? So India cannot work on a situation where you're totally import dependent and we cannot kill the domestic industry for once for all. That's the reason I think this particular last government, 2014, when they came in, they decided to revive the units and the 5 units, and the focus was given more. Even though the seeds of what we call a revival of the units was given earlier government, and the further continued so that you ensure that domestic capabilities are not compromised. Even though, very logically, if you look at it, the entire industry depends on imported raw material, feedstock. Ultimately, technology to manufacture has to be with domestically. And ultimately, the long-term vision of the Indian government is to ensure that even feedstock you find domestically, then you are totally self-reliant, either in terms of in feedstock availability as well as production capabilities. So it is a long-term, certain things cannot be looked at very short-term gains on import, import being cheaper, then you import everything and you don't do the kill the domestic industry. That is not desirable. With the COVID as really proven another big challenge in a situation like COVID, and where everything is important, the countries where import are also stuck by a pandemic. We cannot be a situation where government of India has got a constitutional obligation to ensure that food security is guaranteed by government. Food security can be achieved only by ensuring food grain production, farm food grain production, where a big important supply chain is productivity is achieved by chemical fertilizers. So these are all the lot of and hyperlinks into there. We cannot sit in isolation looking at the cost as the only objective.
Correct, sir. Thank you, sir. That was very insightful. Mr. Hiranand, one of the questions, probably the participants couple of them have asked, sir, that all these SIC units which are getting revived by the government, is there a minimum return which is being guaranteed to the SIC units under the new urea policy? Or is the exact policy only applicable to these SIC units only? Yes, sir.
The particular policy for these revival of units have been framed by government. And we call it NIP 2012, New Investment Policy 2012, under which these old units were to be revived. And some of the brownfield units like Chambal has come up with a unit. For them, the new investment policy was introduced. And this is a special dispensation policy, which is not applicable to other urea manufacturers. And this policy benefit under this policy, or pricing under this policy, will be continue for 8 years. After 8 years, probably these units will come into mainstream urea industry. Now, as far as these units are concerned, see, basically these units have a high capital cost as compared to our old units, which are vintage units in most of the cases. Those have been written off. So basically these units have a high, very high interest burden cost. So that cost has been taken care of under these policies. And these will, and probably most of the investment shall be paid back within about 10 years time. So government has kept this policy for 8 years alive, and after that it will be to mainstream.
Okay, great. Thank you, sir. I think we are with this, we are end with the Q&A round. Over to you, Mradul.
Yeah, thank you, Ravleen. Thank you, Gaurav. Thank you to our guest panelists, Mr. Hiranand and Mr. Muralidharan, for their insightful views. And thanks again to all the participants for taking the time out and being a part of this CARE Ratings webinar. We hope the discussion was insightful and look forward to your participation in future also. For any further queries, feedback or suggestion, you are please welcome to write us in the comment box, which will be coming no sooner the webinar ends. Thank you and goodbye for now.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.